Well, we're learning more about a measles outbreak at Disneyland in California, and turns out it actually may be much worse than originally thought. Health officials now warning about possible exposure from more confirmed cases in California. Here's what we know right now, though. Health officials say that all of these folks got sick after visiting the park between December 15th and December 20th, which means they were likely exposed to somebody there. The State Department of Health confirms now 26 cases, including 22 in California. Four other cases tied to Disneyland are also under investigation. Of those 26 cases, though, four people were sent to the hospital. Measles, of course, is one of the most highly contagious diseases out there, but we still have a lot of questions about it. Dr. Kevin Campbell's with us, a practicing cardiologist and assistant professor of medicine at the University of North Carolina. So it's worse than originally thought, Dr. Campbell, with a few more cases added in just yesterday. Do you think we know the total number as of yet of people infected?
I don't think we do. It's so terribly contagious. When you have one person come into a place like Disneyland that's compacted with lots of people and have the disease, you have the potential to expose 15 to 20 for every one person that has the disease.
You know, it's interesting, though, when I think about Disneyland, I actually don't think about it as too confined, right? Because it's an amusement park. It's not like going to a concert hall or somewhere inside where everyone's sort of together, an airplane, if you will. So how exactly is this disease spread?
So interestingly, the measles itself is a virus, and when you cough and aerosolize that virus into the air, it can hang around in that area for 10, 15 minutes. So you walk through that area, maybe you're going into a ride or something of that sort at Disneyland, and you can be exposed to the virus right away.
Why do you think this is happening? So many are pointing to immunizations or lack thereof. What's your opinion on that?
That's the bottom line. We are not doing as good a job as we need to of immunizing our children. There's been a movement in certain areas of the country not to immunize children, and I think you're putting children and other people at risk. Especially in a place like California, we have a large influx of immigrant population. You have people that may bring that disease from another country, and if your children aren't immunized, they're going to get exposed.
And one of the cases is actually an 8-month-old baby, someone who can't actually be immunized yet to the disease. So there's some innocent folks out there as well that are being impacted by others. I want to ask you about another topic. We were looking at this other study that has more to do with your area of expertise, which is the area of the heart. It's a new study from the University of Illinois, and it shows a link between optimism and heart health. Specifically, researchers discovered that people with a brighter outlook were twice as likely to be in ideal cardiovascular health. The question is, Doc, I mean, we just did a story on measles. We're talking about terrorism, cybersecurity. I mean, I'm sure there's a lot of our viewers who would like to be more positive. But I mean, how much of an impact can that really make on your heart? And how do you do it?
So I think this is an important study. There's been other studies out there that show the same thing. People with less stress, better outlooks, do have better cardiovascular outcomes. This study looked at a large population across all demographics, all socioeconomic statuses, and found a big-time association. I think that when you are stressed, your body releases stress hormones, cortisol, you have higher blood pressure, heart rate, and damage your blood vessels. And I think that by reducing stress, you can reduce your risk of heart disease.
As a doctor, do you ever send a patient to a psychologist or tell a patient, you know what, before we treat you, why don't you try to do some meditation or yoga to get yourself in a better frame of mind? Is that ever something that you prescribe?
You know, I usually share personal experiences with my patients, and I tend to be a high-stress kind of guy, and I talk about how if I just take a deep breath and just sort of clear my mind for 5 minutes a day, take just a little bit of time, it makes those stressful feelings go away for a little while and helps you manage them. I encourage my patients to exercise, find some outlet for the stress so that they can do a better job of taking care of their heart health.
And you actually find that's impactful.
Absolutely. When you convince them. Yeah. And I think that when physicians are able to bond with their patient and give a personal story, they're more likely to believe what you're telling them to do.
So that's what you're doing in our green room before you come on, right? Just a little quiet moment, 5 minutes, get yourself centered.
Exactly.
I'm going to try that, Dr. Campbell. John, maybe we should do that together, John, before we start the show. Five minutes of quiet.
Great idea. Great idea. I'm all for it. All right. Thank you, Dr. Campbell.